From Don Juan by George Gordon, Lord Byron. I want a hero, an uncommon want, when every year and month sends forth a new one, till after cloying the gazettes with Kant, the age discovers he is not the true one. Of such as these I should not care to vaunt, I'll therefore take our ancient friend, John Juan. We have all seen him in the pantomime, sent to the devil somewhat ere his time. His mother was a learned lady, famed for every branch of every science known, in every Christian language ever named, with virtues equalled by her wit alone. She made the cleverest people quite ashamed, and even the good with inward envy grown, finding themselves so very much exceeded in their own way by all the things that she did. 'Tis pity learned virgins ever wed with persons of no sort of education, or gentlemen who, though well-born and bred, grow tired of scientific conversation. I don't choose to say much upon this head. I'm a plain man, and in a single station. But oh, ye lords of ladies intellectual, inform us truly, have they not henpecked you all? Dying intestate, Juan was sole heir to a chancery suit and Messieurs J's and Land's, which, with a long minority and care, promised to turn out well in proper hands. Inez became sole guardian, which was fair, and answered but to nature's just demands. An only son, left with an only mother, is brought up much more wisely than another. Young Juan now was 16 years of age. Tall, handsome, slender, but well-knit, he seemed active, though not so sprightly as a page, and everybody but his mother deemed him almost man. But she flew in a rage, and bit her lips, for else she might have screamed, if any said so, for to be precocious was in her eyes a thing the most atrocious. Among her numerous acquaintance, all selected for discretion and devotion, there was the Donna Julia, whom to call pity were but to give a feeble notion of many charms in her as natural as sweetness to the flower, or salt to ocean, her zone to Venus, or his bow to Cupid. But this last simile is trite and stupid. Her glossy hair was clustered o'er a brow, bright with intelligence, and fair and smooth. Her eyebrow's shape, 'twas, was like the aerial bow, her cheek all purple with the beam of youth, mounting at times to a transparent glow, as if her veins ran lightning. She, in sooth, possessed an air and grace, by no means common, her stature tall. I hate a dumpy woman. Wedded she was, some years, and to a man of 50, and such husbands are in plenty. And yet, I think, instead of such a one, 'twere better to have 2 of 25, especially in countries near the sun. And now I think, aunt, mi vien in mente, ladies even of the most uneasy virtue prefer a spouse whose age is short of 30. 'Tis a sad thing, I cannot choose but say, and all the fault of that indecent son, who cannot leave alone our helpless clay, but will keep baking, broiling, burning on, that howsoever people fast and pray, the flesh is frail, and so the soul undone. What men call gallantry and God's adultery is much more common where the climate's sultry. Alfonso was the name of Julia's lord, a man well-looking for his years, and who was neither much beloved nor yet abhorred. They lived together, as most people do, suffering each other's foibles by accord, and not exactly either one or two. Yet he was jealous, though he did not show it, for jealousy dislikes the world to know it. A real husband always is suspicious, but still no less suspects in the wrong place, jealous of someone who had no such wishes, or pandering blindly to his own disgrace, by harbouring some dear friend extremely vicious. The last indeed's infallibly the case, and when the spouse and friend are gone off wholly, he wonders at their vice and not his folly. Joanne she saw, and as a pretty child, caressed him often. Such a thing might be quite innocently done, and harmless styled, when she had 20 years, and 13 he. But I am not so sure I should have smiled, when he was 16, Julia 23. These few short years make wondrous alterations, particularly amongst sunburnt nations. Whate'er the cause may be, they had become changed, for the dame grew distant, the youth shy, their looks cast down, their greetings almost dumb, and much embarrassment in either eye. There surely will be little doubt with some that Donna Julia knew the reason why. But as for Juan, he had no more notion than he who never saw the sea of ocean. Yet Julia's very coldness still was kind, and tremulously, gentle, her small hand withdrew itself from his, but left behind a little pressure, thrilling, and so bland and slight, so very slight, that to the mind 'twas but a doubt. But ne'er a magician's wand wrought change with all Armida's fairy art, like what this light touch left on Juan's heart. And if she met him, though she smiled no more, she looked a sadness sweeter than her smile, as if her heart had deeper thoughts in store, she must not own, but cherish more the while. For that compression in its burning core, even innocence itself has many a wile, and will not dare to trust itself with truth, and love is taught hypocrisy from youth. Then there were sighs, and deeper for suppression, and stolen glances, sweeter for the theft, and burning blushes, though for no transgression, tremblings when met, and restlessness when left. All these are little preludes to possession, of which young passion cannot be bereft, and merely tend to show how greatly love is embarrassed at first starting with a novice. And if in the meantime her husband died, but heaven forbid that such a thought should cross her brain, though in a dream, and then she sighed. Never could she survive that common loss, but just suppose that moment should betide. I only say suppose it, into nos, this should be entre nous, for Julia thought in French, but then the rhyme would go for naught. He thought about himself and the whole earth, of man the wonderful, and of the stars, and how the deuce they ever could have birth. And then he thought of earthquakes and of wars, how many miles the moon might have in girth, of air balloons, and of the many bars to perfect knowledge of the boundless skies. And then he thought of Donna Julia's eyes. How beautiful she looked! Her conscious heart glowed in her cheek, and yet she felt no wrong. O love, how perfect is thy mystic art, strengthening the weak and trampling the strong! How self-deceitful is the sager part of mortals whom thy lure hath led along! The precipice she stood on was immense, so was her creed in her own innocence. Julia had honour, virtue, truth, and love for Don Alfonso, and she inly swore by all the vows below to powers above, she would never disgrace the ring she wore, nor leave a wish which wisdom might reprove. And while she pondered this, besides much more, one hand on Juan's carelessly was thrown, quite by mistake, she thought it was her own. The hand which still held Juan's by degrees, gently but palpably confirmed its grasp, as if it said, "Detain me, if you please." Yet there's no doubt she only meant to clasp his fingers with a pure platonic squeeze. She would have shrunk as from a toad or asp, had she imagined such a thing could rouse a feeling dangerous to a prudent spouse. I cannot know what Juan thought of this, but what he did is much what you would do. His young lip thanked it with a grateful kiss, and then abashed at its own joy withdrew, in deep despair, lest he had done amiss. Love is so very timid when 'tis new. She blushed and frowned not, but she strove to speak, and held her tongue. Her voice was grown so weak. And Julia sat with Juan, half embraced and half retiring from the glowing arm, which trembled like the bosom where it was placed, yet still she must have thought there was no harm, or else 'twere easy to withdraw her waist. But then the situation had its charm. And then, God knows what next, I can't go on. I'm almost sorry that I e'er begun. And Julia's voice was lost, except in sighs, until it was too late for useful conversation. The tears were gushing from her gentle eyes. I wish, indeed, they had not had occasion. But who, alas, can love and then be wise? Not that remorse did not oppose temptation. A little still she strove, and much repented, and whispering, "I will ne'er consent," consented.